It's pretty accurate, but sometimes it just does introduces a funny word that you then blush. But but I don't know again whether that is visible to everybody or just the person. So just to note that.
Okay. However, it is now 1 o'clock, and Mark, are we in this space? Fabulous, excellent. So we can now seamlessly blend into into Not Crochet with Lynda and Anna.
Yes. So welcome everyone. Yeah, if you obviously have to go, it was good to see the ones that were here with us. So we can, yeah, we were just talking about the accessibility, so turning on the captions if you prefer to follow the conversation that way. And it's already recording, so we don't need to press the recording. So I start by welcoming everyone to our Not Crochet session, facilitated by myself, Anna, Vicente Richards, and Lynda Beckett. The time in London and Yorkshire is 1 o'clock, 1 p.m. We are part of the Experimental Pedagogies Research Group, the PRG, and we are also both PhD candidates at UAL. And we've met through mutual dealings with crocheting. I think that exists as a word. So crochet involves interlacing loops of yarn, which are formed either on a knitting needle or on a crochet hook together in a line, and then in other shapes like jumpers or other things. So we invite you to this space for the next hour to make an improvised knotted piece loosely based on crochet as we think together through any earth, deliberately ambiguous, any earth issues on our minds while we make. We asked you to bring some material, so we're going to go to that in a minute. We will start with a slipknot demo from Lynda, and from there, all the following knots and loops you will make can be improvised as you feel your way through your materials and the conversation. So in other words, we are not teaching you how to crochet, but we are making it up as we go along. You can, of course, adopt a more traditional crochet technique if you know them and if you wish to use it. So this should be a fairly relaxed session as we follow the curiosity of our hands and our minds. There is no expectation of completing an outcome or to arrive at a conclusion at the end. There is no right or wrong way of making. We will encourage you at the end to share what we have made if you feel you want to. So Lynda and I will act as facilitators, participants, and timekeepers, but not as leaders. As all EPRG sessions, this session is intended to be welcoming, non-hierarchical, accessible and inclusive to all. We aim to care for one another and our environment here and to be compassionate in all our responses. Although this event is deliberately experimental, transcripts are available and recordings are being made and will be available to view afterwards. feel free to keep your cameras on or off as you wish. It may be nice to point the cameras to what we are making, but it's not compulsory. So feel free to use the microphone or the chat when you want to speak. So it would be good that people keep an eye on the chat and the contributions on the chat and responses there. Silences are welcome. So there's no expectation that we need to be chatting all the time. And we're recording this session, as you already know. So I'll pass it now to Lynda. You're on mute, Lynda.
Hi, sorry. Hi, I'm Lynda, and I'm going to show you how to make a slip knot. But first of all, I think it would be quite nice if we introduced ourselves and our pronoun and just showed the materials that we have. So if anyone wants to, Anna, do you want to show us what you've got, first of all?
Yeah, so I mean, we kind of all know each other, I think. Let me see the chat. The people here. Yeah, so I think we all know each other. So, but I'm Anna, and I brought this sort of thread, which is what's also behind on my background. Yeah.
Jonathan, have you brought anything? No, it's just okay.
Sorry, Lynda.
I don't know if you brought anything along or if
it's I've got something, but it's across the room. So I was going to turn my camera off to find my
key. Go and get it. Yeah.
I will.
I can show. Oh, Melanie, show us what you've got.
I just found some string. So I've got some string, and I've also got this very old roll of.
Oh, lovely.
Which I've had for ages, and I've never known what to do with it. So I will maybe use
kind
it.
Of a weapon.
It is. I think it's like not bias binding, seam binding.
Yeah. Oh. Excellent. Nice. Does anyone else have any materials? I've got this red wool. It's just really flexible and easy to work with. You've got
Mark, what did you have? Plastic. Right.
Have you got a pair of scissors, Mark?
Yeah.
You might need them.
I've got a pair of Sabatier scissors that I bought. They're beautiful.
Okay, good. Yeah. You might need to make that into strips.
To make it a little bit more easier to work with. Anyone else? Or should I just start and show you how I would begin? So what we really need to do is try and make a slip knot to start with. We're going to be working, or I'm going to be working just with my hands. If you have a crochet hook, then we can go on to that if you want to, but I'm going to be just showing you how to put a slip knot together. I'm right-handed, so what I basically do is just take the thread with the shorter piece in my right hand, twist the thread over my forefinger, then pull it off, and then with my middle finger, just loop that on top of the loop that I've made on my forefinger, and then press the loop through the circle that I made on my middle finger. And you should have something similar to this. I don't know if we're there. How's that? You're all right. Yeah. Okay. And then from there, it's really simple. So So if you just take the loop and then with your other hand, just feed the thread, the long end of the thread through the loop. And then once you've got that, you'll have something like this. And then literally just keep looping and you'll start to get a structure together. Something that looks a little bit like this, kind of like a chain. And yeah, that's basically so what's happening. And once you've kind of got a chain together, really simple, just passing the thread through, really easy. It's quite delicate. And so once you've kind of got a chain together, like something like this, doesn't matter how long it is, you might want to start to, I don't know, form another structure, loop back through, push your long end of the thread through your loop, and then push the long end of the thread. So you're keeping this one in this hand, the long end of the thread through the loop, and put it through the loop that's in your right hand. And then I'm just going to continue to loop it along. So do you want me to start again, Jonathan, so you can see the just the beginning of it, or are you okay?
I'd love you to start again. That'd be wonderful. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. I can do that. No problem. I'll just be there you go. So if you take the piece of thread, you've got the short end in your right. Are you right-handed? Yeah. So you've got the short end in your right hand, long end in your left hand. Twist the thread over your forefinger. So you've kind of got this kind of loop. Yeah. And then twist the thread around your middle finger. Push the loop through the circle that you made on your middle finger, and you should have something like this. Yeah, that'll do. Great. Okay. Hi, Helen.
Hello.
And and then what you do is you take the thread, which is in the long thread, and just pull it through that loop that you've just made. Yeah. That's it. And then again, just pull the thread over into the loop. Again.
Sorry. Yeah.
So the long end of the thread, pass it through the loop that you've just made and make the long end of the thread your loop. That's it. And now bring this thread up like this and then pass it through again. Yep. You've got your long end and your short loop.
Yeah.
Put the loop through again. Have you got that?
Yeah.
And then take long end and pass it through again. So you're basically on your right hand, you're using your middle finger and your finger before your pinky to hold the loop. And on your left hand, your left hand is your feeder, basically.
I've run out of, I thought I had a ball of string, but I've got raffia. and I've run out. Now, I'm not sure that's quite, but I think it's quite a beautiful thing.
That's a beautiful thing. A
beautiful thing.
Yeah. How is everyone getting on? I guess you also make up your own technique and your own way of knotting and looping create shape. And you might, is anyone using a hook, or is everyone using their hands? How are you getting on with your plastic bags, Mark? Oh, you've got thread.
Oh, okay. It's got thread. Okay, that's... If you've got...
Oh, you've got a hook, Ellen. Great.
A hook?
Yeah.
Great.
Excellent.
Oh, great, Melanie. What do you mean you have an extra loop?
I think I'm, when I put it through, I think I end up with an extra loop down the side. And I can't, what I need is to mirror the screen so that I've got it as a mirror so I can copy. We can't mirror these screens, can we? I've just noticed Graham Barton is on there and I instantly want to ask him a question about tech.
did you manage?
I've done it. Can I mirror the screen?
I don't know how to mirror the screen. but if you show me what you're doing, I can guide you. Yeah.
I've got one loop. I unraveled it. I did have right, so I had it here.
So I'm trying with my left hand. So I'm just holding like that, yeah. And then, you know, you can do a loop.
I've got a loop.
Like that, yeah.
Yeah.
So now you just pass through. So just catch and pass through. And then catch that and pass through. Can you see? All right. So you make a thread.
Look, I've got... That goes through there. I'm doing something really stupid.
So if you've got your loop and then you take
you need to tighten it. You need to tighten it. So the first one you tighten it. So it looks like this.
This kind of thing.
Yeah.
What you could do is hold the short end in your left hand,
yeah,
but keeping the loop at the top, and then pass the long end which is now in your right hand through the loop
from the back to the front.
For me, it's the front to the back. Doesn't matter, I don't think. And then. You've then got a loop at the top that you've just passed through, and you're forming another loop like this. So you've got this one here, and then
you've got like a figure of eight.
Got your loop.
Is that right?
You've got your loop, you're passing the long end through the short loop, pulling that up.
Yeah, that's right, Melanie. That's it. Yeah, that's it. Now pass the one on your left through the one on your right. That's it.
Mm-hmm.
Keep it loose. Now do it again. And then you start having a chain.
Got it. Right.
Got it?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
Well done. That's interesting because I've never done it with my left hand. I don't actually know how. I don't actually know any crochet knots. I've never been taught crochet. I just do it intuitively and join one knot to another. So this thing that I've got that I'm wearing, I made, but I didn't follow any patterns. So it's just sort of like going with what feels right. And I think once you get going, you get sort of like a repeat pattern, because you can see there what's happening. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And it is like a. That's amazing, the thing you're wearing.
Why, Lynda? What's the attraction for you to this knot making? What does it feel like? Because I haven't got the feeling of it, so I can't quite understand what the draw to the knotting is.
Okay, so it's a. It's almost like a liminal space. Once you get into the rhythm of it, you enter into a space where you're doing, making, and not necessarily, you're looking at the piece, but you're not, I don't think, oh, I have to go through that loop. I can go wherever I want to go. But it's making some kind of structure as I'm doing it. And I think that it's kind of like being able to have the, not being tied to following a strict structure. And then that enables me to think differently, because I form things differently. And therefore it gives you different spaces to, or different places to step into.
So you're forming something, but not following a pre-designed route to making, that gives you a sense of space for exploration or space for making or
both, space for thinking. And think, well, I don't feel that I think whilst I'm making. I then sort of like, I think that the process enables me to think of different processes. Like, so from this, or just recently, what I've been looking at is like the Baronian knot, Lacanian knot. And I was also looking at the Gordian knot with Alexander the Great, and you know, sort of like the knot was a mass of many things tangled together, and how to explore that, and the knot has many dimensions. It's not binary. There's no inside, there's no outside, because it twists.
Mm.
And that's what interests me. Yes, it is all about rhythm. I agree. Finding different rhythms, I think.
Yeah, you're saying you don't necessarily think while you're making, but I wonder if, you know, how the making, or isn't the making kind of another way of thinking, isn't it? So that's kind of thinking about, can there be, I don't know, that sense of that the thinking all happens in the brain, but can there be sort of brain on the top of your fingers as you feel through as you make? And that, you know, applies to what we're doing right now, but also a lot of other processes that involve the making, even cooking, where you have to manipulate, sort of cut the vegetables and sort of feel the textures, etc. So I think that's quite interesting making, so being engaged in this activity might change how we articulate ourselves through speaking. And I don't know if anyone has any thoughts on that, or other thoughts that matter.
I feel like once I get the rhythm, then I'll be able to speak. But at the moment, I'm having to really concentrate on trying to.
Yes.
But I know that once I get the rhythm, then I'll be able to speak. But I also like the fact that you feel like you can be quiet when you're doing something, because so it's a shared quiet space. Because sometimes, I think we said that earlier, didn't we? Sometimes silence is really awkward. I mean, as a teacher, I often, that's what you're designing, aren't you? You're terrified of the silence emerging. But what I'm having to do is just really concentrate, because it's not, I still can't make it work in the way that I think it should be working. But I don't think that, I think that's something I just have to sort of engage with and think about.
And maybe you have a preconceived idea of what this should be happening. I wonder if you let yourself go and actually just follow what you've got in your hands and what your hands kind of do with it. And if you follow that principle that you're looping and knotting, then there's no particular way that it should be, in a way. I don't know if that sort of helps you.
It absolutely does. And that's what I'm doing. I'm just unpicking it and then redoing it. Because I think, like you said, it's knots, isn't it? So if it's the same knot, that's what you get in that thing that you're wearing, the fact that it's a knot that's repeated.
Yeah.
But yeah, absolutely. I'm just going to keep redoing it until I find a way that it will kind of feel like I've got a repeated line of knots.
Going back to the kind of thinking through making, it's kind of like, I think it's very sort of like, perhaps very binary to think our brain is only in our brain, in our head, rather than a sort of like thinking through sensing and touch and movement.
Yeah.
And also that you know, back to that notion of fear of silence and the filling with silence.
Mm.
Actually, that we, you know, we think that thinking involves words and some sort of, you know, kind of output that is a, I'm struggling with the words here, but some kind of tangible thing, you know, some sort of sense-making thing. And actually, I'm not enjoying the knotting. I've got the wrong material, right? It's not working for me. But
show us your material again. What do you have?
I have a ball of string, but I no longer have I've got some raffia. So it's not nice material. I don't like it. I don't like the feel of it. It's not long enough. It doesn't give me that sense of the possibility of flow. Yeah. What's really lovely, though, is just sitting here watching you doing what you're doing and seeing these, you know, you've got all these little windows with you all around the room with your different colours and your different environments and your different hand movements and your different processes. And actually, that's completely delightful. I don't think I need to be doing it in order to be part of the conversation. No. Actually, it's more interesting for me to watch you and to think about what you're doing. And my thinking is a visual thinking, the relationship of what's in your hand to your bodies, to your backgrounds, to that sort of, you know, as Lynda says, that kind of coming together of, you know, of materials to form these sorts of patterns. So actually the kind of just being in the space is enough. I don't need to be active. I don't need to be a participant in terms of making a thing or saying anything. I'm talking a lot, I know, but actually it's and I think Moni, you're right. We do fear the silence sometimes. But actually, you know, as Mark says, if we can embrace it, if we can allow for those spaces where nothing's happening, you know, where there isn't a quantifiable expression of some kind of understanding. Or validation that we are teaching somebody or that we are learning something or, you know, that something is actually happening. I don't know, all sorts of other things go on. And my enjoyment of this is simply watching you. I feel obliged to talk because it's a space and you know, there's a, I don't know, there's stuff going on in my head. But actually, if I didn't feel this slight obligation, I could very happily just sit and watch.
I think that's really interesting. I think it's in the spirit of experimentation. What it creates is a different online space, doesn't it? It simply by the act of making, but also the backdrop and the fact that both of you have got things that you've made.
Hmm.
So it alters the dynamic of the online space, and it alters the dynamic of the silence that emerges. And I feel like I should be watching what you're doing because I still haven't got it right, but I can't. I just need to engage in what I've got in front of me and take in that the way you conceptualized it, that actually it's knots, and what all you need to be doing is. Well, no, Anna, you said it, didn't you? That it's knots, and you just have to keep.
Yeah, knots and loops.
Knots and loops. Yeah, and I think I hatch like I'm doing it in a completely different way to you, but I think I have actually got to a point now where I'm getting.
That's great.
A repeated knot.
Hello, and how is yours looking?
Sorry.
And how is yours looking?
Oh, yeah, it's going fine, actually. I had a bit of a yarn shortage. I had to knock up some plan quickly. I'm just doing a response to because we're doing a meeting tomorrow, and then I'll come and have a chat and show you what I've done.
Yeah.
I'm using the crochet hook. In the room, sorry, that was the arts festival in the offing. I'm a proponent of freestyle crochet.
Oh, is that what this is? Freestyle crochet,
some people call it that. So it's quite nice. Yeah, so I've just been making that chain. So I think that's I don't know if a crochet chain is quite the same as a knitting chain. It'd be interesting to determine whether Lynda's knotting is more akin to crochet or knitting. You've got a very knitty looking structure there.
Yeah, you do.
Look at that. I don't crochet by the book because I'm a bit cack-handed, but it's immensely satisfying because it grows very quickly.
Is it knitting, Lynda, that you're... Is it knitting, but with your fingers rather than needles?
I don't know, because it's just knotting, isn't it? Because I'm not sort of like, I don't know any, in knitting, I probably know how to knit, and I probably know how to purl. No, I don't even know how to purl. But I just use the thread and know that if you entwine it with itself and then use a loop, that it is going to form a structure. And sometimes sort of like, you know, you can just think I like it because you can do it. You can go off, you can break the rules of tradition, you know, it's sort of like you can, and then just work with it and see what the thread kind of allows you to do, rather than what the instruction manual tells you you have to do.
Yeah, so I guess when you started knotting, you didn't, I don't suppose you looked to knitting or crochet or macrame, which are, you know, sort of centuries old and established sort of yarn crafts, aren't they? And they're kind of sort of global phenomena. Did you just decide to... it's like one of those things. It's like, I think I know what I'm doing. And then you just sort of ran with it.
Well, what I was really interested in is the helix curve and how you can form a helix curve really quite simply. If you knit into the same loop, it very quickly... looks like a DNA structure.
Well, there's a whole theory, body of research, and a group of active yarn crafters globally, isn't there? Who, you know, this is how the Crochet Coral Reef project came about.
Yes, absolutely.
It was the Institute of Figuring. So you've got a group of predominantly female academics who were, you know, also mad keen yarn crafters, and they've written some interesting stuff about that sort of that element of their work. And then the the Crochet Coral Reef, or the hyperbolic, that's what you're looking at, hyperbolic Crochet Coral Reef project has been going probably over a decade now, hasn't it? And it's toured around the world. I think it's still growing.
They were doing it in response to the coral reef in Australia, weren't they? And so it died.
Yeah, there was an ecological sort of purpose as well as this scientific, mathematical, and sort of theoretical sort of movement, I suppose you would call it.
Wasn't the professor trying to teach about hyperbolic curves?
Yeah, there's good stuff. There's papers. There was a website. I think the Institute of Figuring burned down a few years ago.
I think that work is still sort of alive. If anyone's interested, to look at that. What do you use your crochet for, Helen?
What I used it for? Well, I haven't really. This is the first time I've picked it up in ages, and it's annoying because I've got loads of yarn upstairs. It was all buried in a pile of boxes, so I've just knocked that up for you. That's funnily enough, this is one of these compost bags that should biodegrade. So I've just made plan in the good old-fashioned way, where you cut a across your polythene bag so that you have a series of loops, and then you pull one through the other to sort of make a continuous chain. Can you see that?
Yeah.
That's the first time I've ever used plan, which is the plastic yarn sort of moniker it goes by. That's nice.
Could you use it in your garden?
I don't know.
Well, I was just thinking for like beans and things to grow up.
Yeah, I've got a lot of I did 2 hours gardening before this, so yeah, there might be I do a lot of weaving in the garden with sort of bits of plant material, actually, like phormium. It's great for weaving because it's really strong. But yeah, something like this, something knotty. So let's have a look at yours. Oh, yours looks like yours looks like a proper net.
Yeah, it's forming.
Anna, yours looks. That looks like could be a net or a lobster pot thing. You know,
yeah.
Just gone a bit all over the place.
Yeah, it's quite addictive once you get going. You just want to kind of continue, and it sort of goes back to that sort of sense of you find the flow and the rhythm, and it's really satisfying to keep going. When you start with nothing, just like an eventful thread, and you can make this.
Yeah, I think there's I don't know, when you're sort of started, you might have the intention that you want to make something, you know, and it's an object with a purpose, or it's a sort of tangible thing, or it might just be like, oh, well, you know, I've got a bit of time to kill. I quite enjoy doing this. It's quite sort of, it's quite relaxing. It's quite meditative. I personally just like to see more people doing this sort of thing, you know. It's it's kind of relaxing. There's a new crochet fad at the moment, which is pillar box toppers, where people crochet something or knit something which kind of resembles like a beret, and it fits over the top of the pillar box. I've seen them in London because that's where I am, and then it's usually topped with a little mascot that someone's made. So usually that's quite well crafted. And I saw an avocado. It was like a sort of a Japanese cute character avocado on top of the pillar box outside the laundrette in North Dulwich, where I was working on Sunday. And that's all part of that whole gorilla knitting sort of thing, isn't it? I guess.
Wrapping trees.
Yeah, wrapping trees, fences. There was a little bit of that around Grenfell, where I passed by now and again. You know, people had sort of crocheted sort of chains in sort of yellow and green in sort of remembrance. I'm trying to think other examples. No, that's the most recent sort of like urban gorilla knitting that I've come across.
Why do you think that knitting or crochet is the thing that people have taken up as a means of urban expression?
I think it's I don't know for sure. I think that's definitely something to do with sort of women wanting to be more active and have a sort of have a unique and playful kind of medium or activity. You know, it's a response. I don't know that many gentlemen who not, but there are some out there.
I think also it's sort of like a visual but silent almost. And makes you, it's unspoken. It's a way of making an impact without, it's, it remains there. So that's also good.
I think there's a subversive element to it as well. I'm thinking of the cross stitchers who, you know, they sit there over their hoop and then like you see what they've embroidered and it says piss off or something like that. You know, it's, there's that kind of, I think that's been that's been a common thread in women's art, you know, for decades now, isn't it? You know, there's this subversion. You think, oh, we're just doing our handicraft. And then, you know, the reveal is that it's something with a more subversive message.
Mark, what is that, an eventful thread that you shared something? What is it?
That's what you said, Anna.
Oh, did
so,
I?
So you said it was like an eventful thread, and I thought that was rather lovely.
Oh, right.
And I thought I'll write it down, and thinking perhaps that could be for posterity. It's your
oh,
word.
A name for a paper. Oh my God.
Ooh. But I was just thinking when you were talking just then about the, you know, Melanie's plea for pedagogy graffiti. What about pedagogy crochet? You know, this sort of notion of putting things out into the world which have a temporality to them. Yes, things are sort of there for an amount of time, but unlike graffiti, can be adjusted or I don't know. Is there a sensitivity to urban knitting that and no disrespect to graffiti writers who I know take their art very seriously, but you know, there's a sort of a degree of responsiveness to the environment, like those letterbox toppers, which are, you know, pretty site specific. You know, they are berets, as you say, that kind of sit on that structure, but can be removed. You know, it's a process, a bit of subversion, a bit of commentary, but it's not a defacement per se.
Any unravelings yet. I mean, a public unraveling and the public response would be interesting.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. I mean, because in knitting you make, right, and you knot, and things come together, but can be undone, taken apart and reformed, potentially. Ha-ha.
Little plan. Yeah, I think we need Lynda to talk about this, really. I mean, what about unravelling? How do you feel about unravelling, Lynda?
I think that unravelling is probably the process that I do after I form the piece, because the process challenges me to think differently about different texts that I'm looking at, and then sort of like I start sort of like binding them together and unraveling them and trying to find different areas or different methods or different thoughts from them. So it's kind of, yeah, that's the unraveling process for me. Very rarely do I make a piece and then unravel it. So it's much more of a...
physically?
Yeah, it doesn't happen physically. It's a mental thing for me, the unraveling. And that leads to new information, hopefully.
I'm just being a bit of timekeeper. We've got 10 minutes left before the end of this session. I don't know if anyone wants to share, if this would be like a good time to share what we've done, if anyone is interested in doing that and turning on their cameras and show what we've done and any sort of last thoughts before we switch off or switch platforms. I think next session is on Zoom.
It is.
Yeah.
I couldn't make a three-dimensional thing, but I've just been focusing on this knot thing.
We've made, yeah.
And ooh, so...
it's very nice.
I think it's more like a plait, but I think it's just that rhythmicness of the knotting.
Yeah. That's really nice, Melanie. And you sort of found your way to found your own way to doing that. That's really nice.
And have you found that you've got a rhythm there?
Yeah, but I had to do it in a different way because I can't, because it's the left hand, right hand thing. I couldn't follow. But if I get it on YouTube, I can invert it. And then, so it's a mirror. So I think it actually potentially, I can look at the recording that you're making of this, invert it, and then I'll follow it so that I can make... Oh, that's beautiful. Mm. And that's a shopping bag, isn't it? If you make that out of string, you can...
This could be a shopping bag.
They're lovely.
I've always wanted to do the crochet... or knitting, the idea of doing it directly with your hands without not needing the hook or not needing that sort of tool. And it's something that I wanted to do. So this was a good opportunity to try it out. So that's the work of 1 hour, the labor.
Oh, wow.
Oh, amazing. What's that, Mark?
I just thought I'd show you how experienced I am at weaving things. Obviously not. This is my knotting. Look. This is called anarchist knotting, because every time I did one, it went a different way. And I thought, why is it doing that?
What is your material? It's a cable. Brilliant. Yeah.
Weirdly, I've got string or thread or anything in the house at all. It's not brilliant. It's rubbish. This is really bad. And I quite like it because it's bad.
But also, I think it's interesting the material has shown you what to do rather than you forcing something onto the material. So you've given the material its agency.
Or did you intend to make a bowl like that?
Yeah, I mean, it's... my pottery is quite good too, look.
Oh, wow.
or something blue, you know, if you want something. This is the best one, look. Don't you like those?
What did they do?
They're salt and pepper, you see. I'm on my kitchen table. I like that. Look, they're magnets. They go click.
Lovely. We just had a little tour of your kitchen table.
I have to say, can I just say before we that was absolutely beautiful, and then I use that in an absolutely pedagogical way, because actually I learned so much from that. I'm just honest. I don't. That sounds patronising. Apologise, but I think that it's something we should do more often.
Yeah, great. Yeah, so yeah, 5 minutes to go. Thank you to Melanie, Jonathan, Ellen, Graham, Gavin, yay, Dwayne, Mark. Brilliant. Oh, show is yours, Graham. Did you also had a cable? Like,
No, it's like just black cord, oh, yeah. Paracord, I think. Kind of made it into a little necklace.
Oh wow, very decorative. And, for the submarine.
The other end. So I've got another.
If you've got a bungee cord, you know, just go out there and make a hammock ready for the summer. Yes. Now you know how easy it is. You can all go and make hammocks and you can go and relax. It's going to be wonderful.
It's interesting, oh, actually, I was thinking about what someone was saying earlier about kind of in sort of intention, why do something versus actually. Now I'll start again. I think because I came a little bit late. I wanted to come in and say hi, so I had no idea what was going on. So I just wanted to say hello. It's that thing about thinking and thinking through whether you've got an intention for it or not. And because we do a lot of this in various different forms in our work, say from Lego to sound and various other, every material has its own sort of affordance and it's just noticing what you're trying to do and why I want. John, I was thinking about the Jonathan. I was just thinking about the earlier about the Chick Sent Me High's flow and once we were looking at the theory and just thinking about how do you increase the difficulty level. By tearing up bits of paper, trying to get a perfect circle. So you just take a piece of A4 and just try and tear it into a perfect circle. And then you're sort of, for no reason other than just experiment with levels of difficulty. So if you tried to make it perfect, could you change your technique as you tear it up to then go on to the next bit? And then, so there's that balance between noticing whether you then move into flow. So a really simple task can actually then become really complicated. So I was remembering that with the knots, that the distance between all of these is very slightly different, so I might try and focus on that for a bit, which is actually increasing the level of difficulty and possibly getting me into a state of something or other.
Great,
thank you. So it's just great to see you all. It's been a while.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Great. So I think we can, if nobody has anything else to add, there's a really nice words from Dwayne here on the chat. And weaving with words, that's a really nice thought. I think there was that was a little bit on the back of our minds, wasn't it, Lynda? That sense of weaving crocheting and with words as well. I think we must move on to the next. Is there a link here on the, I think yes, we can is. Put, did you put the link on the chat?
The link is there.
Oh yeah, it is, great. Oh yeah, nice to see you all.
Yeah, thank you so much, thanks.
Yeah, thank you for coming in.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, take care.
Fabulous. Thank you.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Hey, Maya. Yes, good. Sorry, I was just trying to work out where I was. But I think I'm here now, which is nice. Yes, I need to make you a.
Hello.
Yeah.
No, oh, we're not here.
No.
No.
You are now host.
Okay.